you. All right, put up my first slide there. Doesn't that fruit look good? Well, okay, some of you don't eat fruit. I get it. Okay, I have a... That looks good to me. I have a banana in my purse for later. So we are talking about in season bearing fruit. And today we're going to be talking about goodness. So join me in this prayer as we want to hear what God has to say for us today. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father and our King, give me eyes to see, ears to hear, a heart to perceive, and the will to obey your word that I hear today in Yeshua's name. Amen. So this is the fifth of the nine fruit that we are looking at. And I believe Adonai and I wants to remind us, I know Rabbi Michael did the same last week, because as we go through these different fruit, it could be very easy that we get this mindset, okay, I have to do something to, you know, to change and to make this happen. But fruit doesn't come because we strive to bear it. As we've said before, it's the result of relationship with Yeshua, and because his Ruach lives in us, it's the fruit of the Ruach, right? The fruit of the Spirit, and that connection, you know, is what allows this fruit to blossom in our life. So David Stern, who is the translator of the Jewish New Covenant, and he also has a small commentary on it, shares this about this concept. He says, fruit does not come from effort or legalistic rule following, but grows naturally out of trust. And what is trust? Trust is a relationship, right? That's the word pisteo in Greek, is to have faith, and it's all a relational thing. So that's what trust is. So David Stern is telling us that it's not by legalistic rule following things, you know, do A, B, C, and you will have goodness in your life, but it's because you have a living relationship with the God of Israel through Yeshua, and his Ruach dwells within you that enables these fruits to flourish in your life. Another writer said, the contrast between works and fruit is important, because when you look at Galatians 5, the entirety of this chapter, the context of the two verses that are the text for our series is that Rav Shaul is contrasting the works of the flesh with the fruit of the Spirit. So this writer says the contrast between works and fruits is important. A machine in the factory works and turns out a product, but it could never manufacture fruit. Fruit must grow out of life, and in the case of the believer, it is the life of the Ruach. When you think of works, you think of effort, labor, strain, and toil. When you think of fruit, you think of beauty, quietness, and the unfolding of life. He goes on to say, the flesh produces dead works, but the Ruach produces living fruit. And this fruit has in it the seed for still more fruit. Love begets more love. Joy helps to produce more joy. And Yeshua is concerned that we produce fruit, more fruit, he tells us, right, in Yochanan 15. Because this is the way that we glorify him. So we have been in this series this summer because it is Yeshua's desire that we bear much fruit. That's what he told his Talmidim. And that is through our connection with the Ruach. So I want us to look at the fruit of goodness today. As we look at our text, once again, Galatians 5, 22 and 23, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, humility, self-control. Nothing in the Torah stands against such these. So last week, Rabbi Michael spoke on kindness, and at first you might think, well, aren't they the same thing, Rabbi Carol? And it's true that we might use those two words interchangeably, but obviously God had something different in mind, that he gives us kindness and then goodness. So there's something different about goodness that he wants us to understand and to know, so that that fruit would be evident in our life. So one Bible dictionary defines goodness in this way. In man, it is not a mere passive quality, but the deliberate preference of right to wrong, the firm and persistent resistance of all moral evil, and the choosing, can you say that word with me? The choosing and following of all moral good. Choosing. Often when we're talking in our studies upstairs, I know in the women's group, I can hear Rebecca often saying, it's a choice, right? It's a choice. And that's true. These fruit of the Spirit, we have a choice to allow them to come out of us or not, right? So we have talked in past times about those fruit testers who come to squeeze us, right? And when they squeeze, what comes out? Well, we have a choice to allow the Ruach to flow through us so that love, joy, peace, and goodness comes out, or we can allow the flesh to rise up, which sometimes we do, and instead of love, joy, and peace coming out, it's anger, etc., worry, and things like that. So we have a choice. No, it's not striving, it's not doing it on our own, but connecting to the Ruach and allowing Him to let these fruit flow out of us. Another author said that goodness is this word for goodness is used only four times in the New Covenant. It comes from a root word, agathos, which is used a lot more times. But this was used only four times in the New Covenant, and it's really not evident in the rest of the Greek world, so it's a very unique form of the word for good. But the writer says that it conveys the idea of benevolence and generosity towards someone else, a going the second mile, where that would not necessarily be required, but you choose to do that. He says that we sometimes speak of a deed done out of the goodness of one's heart, which comes close to the meaning here, except that as with all nine of the fruit, we are dealing with ethical characteristics produced in the believer by the Ruach HaKodesh. Turn to your neighbor and say, by the Ruach HaKodesh. And not with natural qualities or personality traits. My tongue is twisted today, I can tell. Personality traits. Okay, if you're listening to the podcast, my tongue is twisted today, so we'll get through this message. It is, again, it is so easy to think that I need to manufacture these things. Or we can look and say, well, that person is just naturally a good person. That person is just naturally joyful. That's just not who I am, Rabbi Carol. We're not talking about what we naturally are. It is true some of us may have a tendency to be more optimistic while others do not, right? Some may be more in faith while others struggle more. But we're not talking about our natural tendencies. We are talking about something that is able to be cultivated in our lives because we have that connection. And that connection with the vine, we were talking about this week in the Rabbi Michael's office with someone, that connection with the vine allows this fruit to blossom and to grow in our lives. So this is used, as I said, four times in the New Covenant. Galatians 5:22, we know. It's used also in Romans 15:14. Hear what Rav Shaul says to the Romans. Now, I myself am convinced, my brothers, that you are full of goodness. Wouldn't you like to hear God say, you are full of goodness, right? So that's what Rav Shaul was recognizing in the believers here in Rome. You are full of goodness. I'm convinced of this, right? Then in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 9, Rav Shaul tells the Kehillah at Ephesus, for the fruit of the light, who's in the light? Walking in the light of Yeshua. The fruit of the light is every kind of goodness. So I'm only talking about goodness in general, but here Rav Shaul, which could be something to explore, so a little study thing for this week if you would like to do extra study on the topic. Oh, I know, Dan, you want to do it, right? Dad's like, it says every kind of goodness. So there's more than one goodness. Wow, who thought of that? For every kind of goodness as part of being in the light. And then in 2 Thessalonians 1:11, Rav Shaul says to the people at Thessalonica, the congregation there, with this in view, we always pray for you that our God may make you worthy of his calling and may fulfill by his power every good purpose, goodness, that same word, and every action stemming from your faith. So this word has a lot behind it. Again, just a couple other quotes from some articles I was reading. One writer said that goodness is virtue and holiness in action. And I think that's an important thing for us to distinguish. It results in a life characteristic by deeds motivated by righteousness and a desire to be a blessing. Can we all declare this? I want to be a blessing. The fruit of goodness will selflessly act on the behalf of others. And another author said that goodness is not a quality, again, we can manufacture on our own. Yaakov tells us that every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father above. It's that connection. And it goes on to say that this word means to do something for somebody that is so benevolent that person probably can never pay you back, but it really ministers to their need. That's this word, this article said. And there's no thought in this for yourself whatsoever. It's totally benevolent good. There's another word in the Greek used for good, but this word here means benevolent good, the way that God is to you and to me. God is good to us, knowing that we can never repay him. Can someone say, thank you, God? He showers his goodness, his faithfulness to us, knowing that we could never, ever, ever repay him. So that's the goodness that we are talking about today. So I have four or five points here we're going to look at. The first is that we are created to do good. It's the example that Yeshua gave us. Acts 10:38 tells us this about the life of Yeshua, that God anointed Yeshua of Nazareth with the Ruach HaKodesh in power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with them. We are called to be Messiah-like. Our goal is to be more like him and to be transformed. Look what it says in Ephesians 2:10. For we are of God's making, created in union with the Messiah Yeshua for a life of good actions, already prepared for us by God for us to do. You see, our goal is to become more and more like Messiah as we allow ourselves to be transformed by the Ruach. We started this series right after Shavuot. Shavuot is a time where we anticipate and believe for a fresh impartation of the Ruach, but it's not just to stop there. It's supposed to be an ongoing, daily, weekly, monthly, year by year transformation of our lives through the power of the Ruach. And as he transforms us, we become more like Messiah. So that it comes to a point where when people look at you and me, they don't see you, they see Messiah. And when they see Messiah, their lives are changed and touched for good, and hopefully forever transformed as they accept him. So we are told that we were created for a life of good deeds. It's a way of life. It's something seen in our actions. I was reading a story that someone was sharing of a congregation in Romania. And this congregation had no building, and they wanted to build because they were growing and increasing. So the leader of the congregation went to the mayor of the city. This city was a communist city at the time, the mayor was. And he said, no, you can't build this congregation. I'm not going to allow you to do this. So the leader went back, and the people began to pray, and they said, God, we can't do anything beyond what they will allow us to do. So you have to show us, what can we do? We feel we need a building and we want to do this. And God said, I want you to go and do good for these people, to demonstrate my love in your actions. So the leader of this congregation went to the mayor of the city and said, do you have any projects that you need help on? We want to come and help you. And the mayor says, well, I don't have any money to pay you. And the leader said, that's okay. We would just want to come and we want to do this. We want to demonstrate. We just want to come and do this for you. And so this congregation began to do good in this town. One project after another, not receiving any compensation for it. They were just demonstrating God's love in action by doing good for their community. After they'd worked for many, many projects, the mayor called this leader in and he says, I don't understand. He says, what is it about your people? They work so much harder. They have such a greater character. They always have a smile on their face. We pay people, and we can't get them to work as hard as your people do, and they certainly don't have the right attitude. What's the difference? And at that point, the leader was able to share Messiah with them. Their good acts opened up this mayor's heart. And the end result is that he gave them permission to build their congregation, right? So goodness, it has to be seen in our actions. We need to demonstrate our goodness towards other people. When we talk about being like Messiah, imitating him, it means we are becoming godlike in our actions. The whole concept behind what Rav Shaul is telling us is that demonstrating goodness should be a way of life for us. It's not something that we choose to do, you know, every once in a while. In fact, some translations will translate this verse here as walking in a way of goodness, indicating a lifestyle. That's what God is looking for us in all of these fruit, that it's a lifestyle that we have of bearing this fruit. So God wants us to demonstrate our fruit of goodness. He has called us to that. That's what we were created for. The second area that I really felt to encourage us is that we need to seek to do good instead of seeking revenge. 1 Thessalonians 5:15, see that no one pays evil for evil. On the contrary, always, say that with me, always try to do good to each other, indeed to everyone. And in Romans 12:17, repay no one evil for evil, but try to do what everyone regards as good. And one last passage under this is from Luke, when Yeshua is talking to his Talmidim in chapter 6, he says, to you who are listening, I say this, love your enemies. Do good, that's our fruit that we're talking about. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. If someone hits you on one cheek, offer the other too. I don't know, but a lot of us, we get slapped on one cheek, we're coming back with the right hook, right? We ain't gonna stand there and take that, but God is saying demonstrate goodness. If someone takes your coat, let him have your shirt as well. If someone asks you for something, give it to him. If someone takes what belongs to you, don't demand it back. Well, that ain't happening either, right? You know, can you see the kids on the playground? I mean, I had to break up out in the foyer. There's a little toy that they were grabbing and they're pulling mine, and I said, okay, it's mine. I don't know whose it belongs to, and then I gave it to a parent, right? So that's just from a little age, that's our tendency. It's mine, not yours, right? We're not going to let you keep something that you take that belongs to me, but that's what goodness is, and that's what Yeshua tells us to do. Verse 31, treat other people as you would like them to treat you. What credit is it to you if you love only those who love you? Why, even sinners love those who love them. What credit is it to you if you do good only to those who do good to you? Ah, see, this is the key here in this section, is doing good even to those who don't do good to you. Even sinners do that. What credit is it to you if you lend only to those who you expect will pay you back? Even sinners lend to each other expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies, do good. And lend expecting nothing back. Your reward will be great, and you'll be children of Ha-Elyon, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. God demonstrates goodness to us and expects us to demonstrate goodness. There are many opportunities that we each face in life on a regular basis, if not daily, definitely weekly, where we could seek to retaliate because someone has been rude to us, someone has, you know, perhaps even maligned us by a word they said, maybe on the job or something like that. And there's an opportunity to rise up and to seek revenge and say, you know what, I'm going to, if nothing else, give this person a piece of my mind and let them know where they are wrong, etc. But God tells us, don't repay evil with evil. And I know that's hard, and I can hear your mind saying, but, but Rabbi Carol, you don't get it. They need to know that what they did is wrong. And I'm going to tell them that what they did is wrong. See, well, God say, no, you're not going to tell them. Instead of repaying evil with evil, you're going to do good to that person. But it's my right. I don't want to be trampled all over. They don't have a right to treat me that way. Repay evil with good, God tells us. Our tendency, again, is to want to defend ourselves, to speak up, and to get back at the person who has offended us, who has hurt us, who has done whatever, quote, evil to us. But we are encouraged here in these three passages that I've read, and there are many others, instead of doing that, seek to do good. When someone has done something that adversely affected you in any way, you need to seek to do good. When a coworker lies about you and it leads to you being called into your supervisor's office, I know that never happens to anyone here, the last thing you want to do is be good to that person because you're mad at them because you didn't do anything wrong. But God tells us to do good to those who hate us, right? Yeshua says, those who hate you, those who persecute you, do good. So we have to allow this fruit to come out of us, even in adverse situations. Because Yeshua said, it's not a big deal if you're good to people who are good to you. So we can be good to one another here in the congregation because for the most part, I know we have a few moments when we're not good, but for the most part, we're on our best behavior and we're good to one another. And it's okay to be good. We smile and we hug and, oh, we're good, good, good. Yeshua says, big deal. Even non-believers can be good to people who are good to them. The fruit of goodness is really demonstrated in that adverse situation, in that uncomfortable situation where someone has done something, where they have demonstrated hatred towards you, persecuted you, and yet you are still able to let goodness flow out of you. That's what God is looking for us. In fact, what God is telling us in these three verses is that we need to actually actively pursue doing good. Remember, it's something seen in our actions. In one of the articles I read, it said it's not a passive thing. In other words, oh, if I happen to have a chance to be good, okay, I will. No, we actively pursue being good. That's what these scriptures are telling us to do. And again, it can only happen as we tap into the Ruach, because he knows that you're fuming mad inside. He knows you're ticked off about what happened. But when you're able to surrender those emotions, say, okay, Ruach, flow through me and let the fruit of goodness come out towards this person. The third thing I want to encourage us about is to do good to those who can never repay you. The book of Yeshayahu, Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17, we are encouraged. Learn to do good. Seek justice, relieve the oppressed, defend the orphans, and plead for the widow. Just on a side note, we'll be talking about this more in the future. Rena and Rabbi Michael and I and Abigail went this week to a meeting of our section about the issue of, you know, of abortion and the laws that were passed here in New York State. And in October, we'll put this date out here to you, October 26th through November 2nd, we're going to participate with an organization called Life, Love Life, right? Thank you, Love Life. And they ask congregations to commit a week. So they have, usually do 40 weeks. They're doing a truncated one this fall here in the Northeast. But they do 40 weeks representing the 40 weeks that the child is in the womb. And we are going to, again, be part of defending those who cannot defend themselves. So we'll be keeping you informed about that. But just want to let you know that that's something that we have been waiting so that we could go to this meeting and hear how we can cooperate as a community, not just here, this personal community of Beth Emanuel, but the community of Messiah here on the island. So, but this verse here is telling us to do good for those who will never, ever be able to do anything to pay back that goodness. Sometimes it's often easier to do good when we know that that goodness will be reciprocated to us. You know, that even though we're not necessarily looking for you to do anything, we know eventually down the road, I'm good to you, you be good to me, you know, you, or they have the means to do that. It's sometimes easier to be that way. However, when we're confronted with the needs of others around us in our community or on the job, sometimes we easily turn our head the other way because that person may not fit our ideal of someone that we want to help. They might be a little different from us, come from a different background than we do. And sometimes it's because we feel that the other person is always taking and looking for people to give, and we get tired of giving, you know, is sometimes part of the issue. But yet God wants us to do good even in those situations to those who we feel might not deserve our goodness. I know that all of us are going to rally behind, you know, the cause of the unborn. It's like a no-brainer, we get that. And so, again, that's going to be for another time. But there are others in our community who need goodness to be demonstrated to them. And sometimes we pass them by because we just don't think they are deserving of it, or we don't want to get involved, okay, in the situation. Because demonstrating goodness or any of these fruit of action, these fruit of the Ruach, not only does it take action on our part, but sometimes it takes time. And, you know, I have my life, God. You know, I have the things that I already do. And maybe to be good to someone means you might have to give up an evening to go help them do something that you weren't planning to do. You hear what I'm saying? So God wants us to do good to those who can never repay us and or necessarily help us. One writer put it this way: we are called to be champions and advocates when people cannot advocate for themselves. These groups that are mentioned here in Isaiah are groups who are vulnerable, the widow, the orphan, the oppressed, and we need to seek to do what is right for those who are in need. The Hebrew word here has a connotation of, again, being diligent. Like we said in the passages from the New Covenant I read a while ago, it's about being on purpose, being intentional. Here, being diligent. In other words, we're going to purposely seek to do good and to help those who need our help. And so we need to look for opportunities to do good in our community, both within the Kehillah, both within the Kehillah here and with the community at large. Again, there are opportunities all around us that we could do good for those in our community. And each week, I believe Adonai presents us with situations at work or in our families, in our communities, where we could demonstrate goodness and we just miss them because we're just so involved in doing our stuff. And we need to be a little more diligent to look to do good to people who are in need that God has placed in our life. And next, I just want to encourage us, don't stop doing what is good. 2 Thessalonians 3:13, you brothers who are doing what is good, don't slack off. Or one translation says, never tire of doing what is good. And Galatians 6, 9, and 10, many of us can quote this. So let us not grow weary of doing what is good. For in due season, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as the opportunity arises, let us do what is good to everyone, and especially to the family of those trusting faithfully. Most of us quote this scripture just about just hang in there, so God's going to fulfill his promise for you. And that's a principle that you can see in this. But you have to look at this passage. It says, don't grow weary of doing what? What is good. See, the whole context of these two verses is on goodness. For if we don't give up, we'll reap. Therefore, as the opportunity arises, let us do what is good. You hear what God's saying? Go ahead, you can claim it. God, my harvest is coming done. He says, if I don't go weary, reap. Yeah, I've done the same thing. But as I looked at this verse this week, this context is all about goodness and demonstrating and doing good. And sometimes we do grow weary. Sometimes we feel like we give and give and give and are demonstrating not just goodness, but all these different fruit. And we can come to the point where we say, well, when will it be my turn that someone gives to me? And, you know, why is it always me, God? Why can't someone else step up to the plate to show goodness? And I hear those little brains going, right? I know other people besides me have had those thoughts. Why is it always me, God? Why aren't other people doing their part? And we can be overwhelmed by the magnitude of situations in which we are demonstrating these fruit and giving of ourselves. Goodness, kindness, patience, and all the other fruit. And when we see little response, because, you know, sometimes when you demonstrate goodness to people, they don't always thank you. Did you notice that? Right? They don't always say thank you. They don't always, you know, not that you're looking for reciprocation or even that, but when you're doing on a regular basis and you never get any gratitude expressed towards you, right, you can get a little weary in doing that. And this is what God is talking about here. Don't grow weary in doing good. You're going to reap a harvest, maybe not in that situation, and maybe that person will never say thank you, and definitely maybe that person will never have the ability to give back to you in any way, but God has the ability, right, to pour into our lives. And that's what we're talking about here. But he says, but you keep doing what is good. You keep letting that fruit come out of you in every situation and circumstance. Don't slack off. Sometimes we fall in the rut and we just stop being diligent and intentional in seeking to do good for others. One writer explained it this way: doing good requires continued effort, constant toil, but human nature, being fond of ease, lacks staying power, is easily discouraged, and this is especially true when results are not always apparent at once. When those who should help refuse to cooperate, and when no reward seems ever to be coming our way. But God says, don't grow weary, keep doing good. Another insight shared by this writer says, do not be misled. Do not let a few people who neglect their duty keep you from doing yours. Never grow tired of doing what is right. Can I say that to you guys? Never grow tired of doing what is right. No matter what anyone is doing around you, if you are the only person in your family, if you're the only person in this congregation, if you're the only person at your workplace, if you're the only place in your community who is demonstrating this fruit of goodness, don't stop doing it. Keep doing goodness. Keep letting that fruit come out of you. That's what God is telling us. Don't stop. Don't go weary. And finally, I just want to encourage us that there is fruit that we will reap. The scriptures give us these different things as the fruit of being good, doing good. Tehillim 37, verse 3, and then 27. Trust in Adonai and do good. Settle in the land and feed on faithfulness. God says that we will be settled securely. That's what that whole imagery is there. Verse 37, if you turn from evil and do good, you will live safely forever. And Kepha Aleph, 1 Peter 3, 10 through 11 says, whoever wants to love life, my hand's up, I want to love life. Anyone else want to love life with me? Whoever wants to see good days, that's me. Trust must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and chase after it. I want to love life. I want to see good days. God's telling me that's the fruit of doing good. All of these verses encourages us that we will live in peace, we will enjoy a good life, the abundant life that Yeshua says he came to give us as a result of doing good. Security will be ours. I think that's good return on our giving of goodness. Don't you think so? Again, not anything we can manufacture or do on our own, but let us be connected to the Ruach. Let us allow him to flow through us in the fruit of goodness to impact the world around us. We choose to do good, not only will we be blessing other people, but God's blessing will flow into our life. I want to close with this scripture from Colossians 1, 9 through 10. This is Rav Shaul's prayers. I love his prayers over the different kehilot. So this is the prayer I pray over you today. I ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will and all the wisdom and understanding which the Ruach gives, so that you may live lives worthy of the Lord and entirely pleasing to him, being fruitful in every good work and multiplying in the full knowledge of God. May that be upon you in Yeshua's name. Amen. I want to close with the Aaronic benediction. Again, we have cake and coffee upstairs for Rabbi Michael's birthday, so please stay. Even if you had some plans for this afternoon, just grab a piece of cake and coffee quick, and then we will see everyone. Wednesday night is our Chavarut groups this week, and Monday is our movie night, so we welcome you to come and be part of those. So let me close with a Aaronic benediction. I'll call up any of our prayer team to come up. If you do need prayer before you go upstairs, we'll be here to pray for you, and then we'll come up to have cake and coffee with everyone. Yevarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha. May Adonai bless you and keep you. Ye'er Adonai panav alecha v'yikunecha. May Adonai make his face shine on you and show you his favor. Yisa Adonai panav alecha v'yisim lecha shalom. May Adonai lift up his face towards you and give you peace. May you walk in the peace of God in this week. In Yeshua's name, amen. Shabbat shalom.